Just like old time. We breathe deeply and allow ourselves to be still, find that inner center as we listen to the words of our sacred reading.
We want relief. Cure is painful. By Anthony DeMeo. Spirituality means waking up. Most people, even though they don't know it, are asleep. They're born asleep. They live asleep. They marry in their sleep. They breed children in their sleep. And they die in their sleep without ever waking up. They never understand the loveliness and the beauty of this thing we call human existence. You know, all mystics, no matter what their theology, no matter what their religion, are unanimous on one thing, that all is well. All is well. Though everything is a mess, all is well. Strange paradox, to be sure. But tragically, most people never get to see that all is well because they are asleep, because they are having a nightmare. Last year on Spanish television, I heard a story about this gentleman who knocks on his son's door. Jaime, he says, wake up. Jaime answers, I don't want to get up, Papa. The father shouts, get up, you have to go to school. Jaime says, I don't want to go to school. Why not, asks the father. 3 reasons, says Jaime. First, because it's so dull. Second, the kids tease me. And third, I hate school. And the father says, well, I am going to give you 3 reasons why you must go to school. First, because it is your duty. Second, because you are 45 years old. And third, because you are the headmaster. So wake up. Wake up. You've grown up. You're too big to be asleep. Wake up. Stop playing with your toys. Most people tell you that they want to get out of kindergarten. But don't you believe them? Don't you believe them? All they want to do is to mend their broken toys. Give me back my wife. Give me back my job. Give me back my money. Give me back my reputation, my success. This is what they want. They want their toys replaced. That's all. Even the best psychologists will tell you that people don't really want to be cured. What they want is relief. Cure is too painful. Waking up is unpleasant, you know? You are nice and comfortable in bed. It is irritating to be woken up. That's the reason the wise guru will not attempt to wake people up. I hope I'm going to be wise here and make no attempt whatever to wake you up if you are asleep. It's really none of my business, even though I may say to you at times, wake up. My business is to do my thing. Dance my dance. And so it is.
And so it is. Well, let's all wake up together to that reality, to that love that is the presence of the Absolute, that wholeness that encompasses all of life and all beings. Some know it as the I Am presence. Together we sing, I am remembering who I am. And as we know who we are, that we are one with wholeness, let us know it for ourselves and for all beings everywhere. I am remembering who I am. In divine remembrance, in a state of being, in love, let us breathe in deeply, and then exhale, opening our eyes in love and service to what is, as it is, and so it is.
Watching the sun, watching it come up over the rooftops. Cloudy and warm, maybe a storm, you can never quite tell from the morning. And it's going to be a day. There is really no way to say no to the morning. Yes, it's going to be a day. There is really nothing left to say but come on, morning. Waiting for mail, maybe a tale from an old friend or even a lover. Sometimes there's none, but we have fun thinking of all who might have written. And it's going to be a day. There is really no way to say no to the morning. Yes, it's going to be a day. There is really nothing left to say but come on, morning. And maybe there are seasons, and maybe they change, and maybe to love is not so strange. Sounds of the day, they hurry away, and now they are gone until tomorrow. And then day will break, and you will wake, and you will rake your hands across your eyes and realize that it's going to be a day. There is really no way to say no to the morning. Yes, it's going to be a day. There is really nothing left to say but come on, morning. Seasons, and maybe they change, and maybe to love is not so strange.
So I'm going to start by telling you a story. There was once a minister who had a center of love. Let's call her Reverend Connie. And this minister really, really, really wanted to understand the nature of love. So she studied love. She took a seminar on love. She researched love. She read 12 books on love. Still, there was something missing. So one day, she decided to go down to the beach and walk along the shore with her two poodles. And she happened upon a little boy who was there with a cup, dipping the cup in the ocean, and then looking at the water in the cup. And she asked him what he was doing, and he said, "I am studying the ocean by gathering some of it in this cup. Through gathering the ocean in this cup, I will know all about the ocean." And then the little boy morphed into an angel and said, "Beloved Reverend Connie, you have been like this little boy, trying to understand the ocean in the cup of your own mind. What you need to do to really understand the ocean is to dive in." You're welcome. How do we dive into that ocean of love? You know, a term that really none of us can understand with our intellect. Well, I think one of the ways that we can dive into the ocean of love is through a non-linear, paradoxical process, what I call love's secret weapon, what I call a delivery system for love, and that is through forgiveness. Oh, yeah, forgiveness, yeah. It's the hubbub. Forgiveness. A Course in Miracles says that forgiveness will give you everything you want. Richard Rohr says that forgiveness is the central message of the gospel. I say forgiveness rules, it rocks. I've had the opportunity recently, my schedule has opened up a little bit, so I've had a little more time to contemplate about my life and what I'm doing and where I could do differently, and just decided to up-level my forgiveness practice. And I believe what it says in the Course in Miracles, forgiveness gives you everything you want, because having up-leveled my forgiveness practice for the last month or so, I feel a great opening to greater love, to greater expression of love. It's affecting all of my relationships. It's affecting my relationship with my family, my husband, my animals. It's affecting my relationship with myself, for all forgiveness is self-forgiveness. It's affecting my relationship with the center. It's affecting my relationship with sleep. I can sleep a lot better now that I've been practicing forgiveness in a rigorous way. And so I offer that to you this day, on Father's Day, just in case any of you fathers feel like you need to forgive yourselves. Just in case anybody here feels like they need to forgive a parent, just in case anyone here feels also like they need to forgive someone or forgive themselves. There's always room for forgiveness, and forgiveness is a blessed and a beautiful thing. If forgiveness is so great, why do we resist it? Why do we sometimes avoid forgiving, even though we've heard in church or someplace else that forgiveness is a beautiful thing? I think it has largely to do with what I just talked about, the trying to understand forgiveness with your logical mind, with your linear mind. It's not linear. It's not logical. The logical mind wants to separate categories into good and evil, right and wrong, dark and light. We constantly want to separate stuff when really there is an unbroken wholeness that contains all of that. And forgiveness moves us into that place where we are perceiving and living from that place of unbroken wholeness. We also have to be careful that we don't shame ourselves for quote-unquote failing at forgiveness or not, or looking at things and dividing things into right and wrong, because it's essential for our survival at times. You know, many of you know that I have a strong relationship with the animal kingdom, right? It's kind of like Lord of the Flies over at my house because we have a lot of animals. And our most recent animal is a bunny rabbit called Hip Hop. She's a Flemish giant, which is one of those really like huge rabbits. She's still young, but she's going to be a 20-pounder, I think. She's really big, and she's got huge ears. And her full name is Hippolyta, Queen of the Amazons. Now, all of my animals have songs, many songs written about them, and Hippolyta's song is, "It's Hippolyta, the Queen of the Amazons, bunnylicious of the free and the brave." Everybody, it's okay. Poor Hugh has to hear that song like 20 times a day as I'm marching around as a rabbit. But anyway, I bring that up because when I have this ritual that I do in the morning. I go and I feed the dogs and the cat, and I get some carrots out of the refrigerator, and I stand around the corner from where the rabbit's pen is in the living room, and I look around the corner so I can see her, and she can't see me. And I start singing the Hippolyta song. And I am telling you, by the time I get to the words, "Bunnylicious of the free and the brave," her little ears go like that. And then she runs over to the side of the fence and she's looking for a carrot, right? So she is dividing reality into, this is a good thing that's about to happen. But if one of the dog barks at her sharply, she'll slap her back feet and she says, "Oh, this is a bad thing that's about to happen." And we do that all of the time. We are constantly dividing reality into this is good, this is bad. When I sang in opera chorus years ago, a little rusty, by the way. But anyway, when I sang an opera chorus years ago, we did our best, but sometimes there was a lot of music to learn, and sometimes we didn't know what the soloists were saying. So we'd just all be huddling in the chorus going, "Is this a good thing or a bad thing?" And they'd go, "It's a bad thing." We'd be like, "Oh, is this a good thing? Oh, we're all happy now." Super professional, right? But that's what we're doing all the time. We're saying, is this a friend or is this an enemy? Is this a good thing or is this a bad thing? And we are adjusting accordingly. Now, how this works in the metaphor of how we respond to life and how we react to life, I'll tell you a story about how that works. The other day, I was in class with beloved Chris and Meenal, taking their wonderful relationship class. And they asked us before the class, before we got into the heart of the matter, to release anything that might keep us from being fully present. And the thing that I released was pesky Buddhists. All of them, all Buddhists everywhere. I was disturbed by the Buddhists. You know how those Buddhists are, right? Sorry, I can't even do this with a straight face. So I know we have Buddhists in the congregation. Later, somebody came up to me and said, "Why are you upset with the Buddhists?" "Is this about me? You know, is she friend or enemy?" And I said, "Well, really what's happening is that I'm emceeing a Buddhist convention, a Buddhist two-day workshop at the end of the month up in Northern California, and it's turning out to be a much bigger deal than I thought it would be. And I was on a conference call with the Buddhists, and they were telling me all of the stuff that I have to do, like memorize all of these bios of people, and I'm saying to them, I can't even pronounce their names. I don't know what I'm doing. But anyway, it's a great opportunity, and I want to do a good job. But what I did was I decided that the Buddhists had made me feel something that I didn't want to feel, which was fear. Fear of failure. So I didn't, instead of wanting to feel the fear of failure, I decided to blame the Buddhists instead, right? We do that all the time, but in acknowledging it, because I had practice, I've been practicing forgiveness, I was able to look at the real problem. The real problem is not the Buddhists. The real problem was my fear of being a failure. And then I get to acknowledge that and work with it and address it. It comes up to be revealed and healed. And that's why forgiveness is so beautiful, because not only you're forgiving those people that you're blaming, calling pesky or whatever, you're forgiving yourself that it's okay to be afraid. It's beautiful to be afraid. It's beautiful to see it and beautiful to work with it in a way that brings forth the highest and the best for all beings in that particular situation. So I no longer think the Buddhists are pesky. If you're Buddhist, I apologize for my... Please forgive me. But you may want to look at yourself and see where you are mired in blame or resentment and say, is it because this other person or this other entity or this other organization or what have you is bringing up within me feelings that I do not want to feel, and then allow the feelings and then see what they have to tell you, see what they have to share with you? That's a big part of the practice. I'm going to tell you how I've been practicing forgiveness in the last month or so, and up-leveling my forgiveness practice. And if you want to take any of this on, you're welcome to, or you can find your own forgiveness. I've been researching forgiveness a lot too, you know, using my brain to understand forgiveness. And there's so much material out there, and much of it is really good. So one of the things that I'm doing in terms of, or one of the things that we can do in terms of understanding forgiveness is to look at, I call it minding the gap. I think I'm stealing that phrase from somebody else, but minding the gap. You, of course, allow the feelings to arise. We don't want to push down our feelings, but we allow the feeling of resentment or shame or whatever it is to come up, feeling blamed, feeling falsely accused. We allow that to come up, but then we look for that little gap. We feel the sensation in our bodies of what that feels like, but we look for the gap for right before the story starts about it, right? With the Buddhists, it was, I'm feeling uncomfortable. And then I noticed where I started telling the stories that these Buddhists were against me. It's kind of funny with using Buddhists, right? Yeah. But whatever's going on, we look at the feelings, we allow them to be, and then we just look at that little gap and see if we can pinpoint the precise moment where the story starts and what the story is. And then we can take it from there. We can recognize that the story is just a story. It is perception, and it is not global universal truth. It is our perception. It is our perception. So we can look at the thought that maybe there's another way to perceive this. Maybe the other person is perceiving this in a way that is completely appropriate for them. And if there's a conflict, maybe I can learn to perceive this differently. And I can work on myself from this standpoint of minding the gap between sensation and story. It's a beautiful practice. And the good news about life is that you get to work on it all the time. The other practice I've been doing is the Ho'oponopono prayer. It's a Hawaiian prayer that has mystical and powerful properties, and I know a lot of you know it and we've said it, so I'm not going to go into the whole story of what it is, but I will say that the words of the Ho'oponopono prayer are... How does it start? I love you, thank you, I love you. I forgive myself for forgetting the Ho'oponopono prayer. I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. I'll say it one more time. You can say it with me if you want. I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. That prayer is really interesting to me because let's say you're angry at somebody else, right? And you're not saying, I'm going to forgive you. You're saying, please forgive me. And that's kind of interesting, right? I think that supports the idea that all forgiveness is self-forgiveness, because the truth is about that disturbance that is quote-unquote caused by the other person is that it wouldn't take root unless we had some type of attachment to it. Lots of groans today. You know, this is not blaming the victim, it is empowering the victim, okay? I'm going to talk about that in a minute, but I want you to hear this with an open mind. It's probably better served by a story. And this is the third thing that I've been doing, is taking responsibility for whatever I feel, right? Not blaming the Buddhist because I'm uncomfortable, recognizing that I don't want to feel the fear of being in a new situation with names I can't pronounce and huge bios that I can't remember, okay? So, taking responsibility, understanding that there is a hook in me that reacts to certain people in a certain way, that causes there to be this interlocking rather than having me be Teflon and having the quote-unquote insults slipping right off of me. The story that I have is about a good friend of mine that I knew in New York. He was actually my best friend for quite a while. He gave me away at my wedding, and we were really, really close friends. And we were psychiatric nurses together. His name was Mike. He's passed away. He died of AIDS in the 90s, so that's why I'm speaking about him in the past tense. But anyway, we were psychiatric nurses together, and Mike was excellent at talking people down who were in a violent stance. People that were being aggressive, people that were in danger of becoming assaultive. He was so good at talking down combative patients. Talking down means calming down, right? Calming down combative patients. And then there was one day when this woman was yelling at everybody and yelling at him, and she said, as he was trying to work his magic, she said to him, "You are so ugly, you're never going to find anyone to love you." Now, it's pretty cold, but I've seen him been called much worse than ugly, right? I've seen him be called much worse than ugly, and the truth was, when I spoke to him about it later, is that he kind of believed it. He believed that he wasn't attractive, and he believed that he could never really find somebody to love him. And that's why it stuck. That's why it stayed. That's why it stuck on him, because he believed it. So when somebody seems against you, when somebody is insulting you, when somebody is disapproving of you, isn't it a great opportunity to look inside and see, is there part of me that believes this? Is there part of me that is ashamed of who I am? And is there a part of me that is separate from the field, that feels separate from the field of wholeness that I already am? Because face it, folks, if you are here, you are one with wholeness and you are one with love. We just don't always remember and we just don't always act like it, right? Everybody nod your heads, right? We are one with wholeness, yeah. I want to address the idea if somebody is really unfortunately aggressive and violent and you feel threatened. There's a story that my prayer partner told me about us in a zoo in India. There was a guy that worked with the exotic snakes. And for some reason, I don't know why, but the snakes were not, the poison wasn't taken out of them, right? You can do that with snakes, I've heard. You can take the poison out of them. This guy got bit numerous times by poisonous snakes. And he did what he needed to do to protect himself most of the time. He contained the snake, and he lived. But he didn't really blame the snake for being a snake. That's what Rupert Spira says, a wonderful non-dual teacher. He says, of course, when people are aggressive or vigorously unkind to you, there is this natural physical reaction that is wise, that is good, that is saying, this is a bad thing, this could hurt me, this could really damage me, I need to get away from this. But he adds that we don't get away, we don't set limits, we don't psychically hold them with any animosity. We say instead, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. We understand that they are acting from a place of pain and ignorance. And if we react from a place of pain and ignorance, then that just continues to perpetuate the cycle. It's like Michael Beckwith talked about, Michael Beckwith, who's the minister of Agape, a large spiritual center, he talked about how when Jesus says, turn the other cheek, he doesn't mean turn your other cheek so somebody can slap, right? So somebody can slap you on that side as well. He means offer a completely different perspective. So if somebody approaches me with aggression, I will approach them back with love. Even if it means I have to set boundaries, I will do so with love. I learned this actually from one of our practitioner emeriti in a big way, Mike, who worked in the FBI. And, you know, Mike, I hope it's okay that I'm telling this, but he said that it was challenging at first to reconcile this loving teaching with putting criminals behind bars. And he learned to say that it was not so much about punishment, it was about consequences. So if you treat me badly, if you are unkind to me, I will back away, but I'll continue to love you from afar. Right? So is it possible to apply that to your life? To look at somebody, whether it's a personal relationship or a relationship with somebody on the news or a relationship anywhere, is it possible to hold that person with love and still understand that what they are doing is not appropriate? Is that possible? Okay, good. It's not easy, but it's possible, and it takes practice. The last thing I want to tell you is from Richard Rohr. Richard Rohr talks about when his mother was dying. She was The family was sitting vigil around the bedside, and the mother was clearly dying. She was clearly letting go of this human body, and she was saying to her family, it's like there's a mesh, there's like a net that's holding me back, keeping me from crossing over that threshold. And Richard Rohr, being who he is, said, I wonder if you need to do some forgiveness work. And so she spoke with every single member of the family and said, I love you, I forgive you, and they forgave her for any wrongdoing that they had done. And then it came time for Richard Rohr's father to come. And he said, my beloved wife of 54 years, I love you, I forgive you. And she folded her arms and said, nope, I'm not going there. I'm not going to give this back to you. And Richard Rohr said that he took her by the hand and he started kissing her hand. And he said, I know that there is a power and a presence that can melt your heart, that can soften your heart. And after a while of doing this, after an hour or so, the father came back in the room and the mother said, I do forgive you and I love you and I let you go. Please forgive me for anything that I have done that's been unkind or inappropriate. Shortly after that, she said that the mesh was dissolving and she felt like she could transform into her new life beyond this body. And one of the last things that she said to Richard Rohr before she left her body was, tell your sisters who are married to do this with their husbands sooner rather than later. Please repeat after me. I love you. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I thank you. Forgiveness gives us everything we need. Let us pray. And so we turn within to rest in this spaciousness that is created by our time together, by our willingness to be outside of time and space and just be in this beautiful awareness that is so powerful and so present. It is the life of the I am. It is the life of the absolute wholeness that embraces everything. It is the life of love that is seeking expression, not only expression in the world, but expression through each of us individually. How wonderful it is to know that we are part of this love and that this love longs to express in individualized, multiple creative ways through every single person here today and all of those that we love. And so I know that a pathway to this love, to the fullness and the expression of this love, is through the practice of forgiveness. If there is anybody that we are holding in our hearts, if there's anybody that feels against us, let us commit today, if we can, to start where we are, but to move towards greater forgiveness and to move towards greater love. And if we are holding ourselves with any shame or with any blame or with any regret or any guilt, let us understand that all of that is getting in the way of the full expression of love, and it is okay for us to forgive ourselves as well. I know that there is a power and a presence that is greater than our small minds that is already doing the work through us. And so we say yes. We say yes to it. We allow it to be. And we watch our lives change for good as we engage in this creative and loving process. I am so grateful for this sacred time together, so grateful for this spiritual center, and so grateful for the transformation I know is going to occur through our time that we have spent here this Sunday morning and through our community and through our work. I bless all paths to God, churches, synagogues, temples, mosques, ashrams, fundamentalists, atheists. I bless Buddhists. Yes. And with a heart that is so filled with blessedness, I say thank you, Spirit, thank you, God, and I release these words into the divine mystery, and together we say, and so it is. I am so blessed.
Watching over me, my Lord. Angels are watching, watching over me. 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 Angels are watching, watching over me.